Good evening and welcome to the Late Show. Today is Monday the 24th of April and I'm hosting tonight's programme, Simon Barrett. My special guest is spokesman on behalf of the Armenian community. His name is Rafi Sarkisyan and you're representing the Armenian community. So it's an absolute pleasure to have you on the Late Show today, Rafi.
It's always a pleasure.
And I remember interviewing you on the Middle East Report 2 years ago when we looked at the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide.
That's right.
And they were extremely powerful programs and I've learned so much and I'm sure a lot of our viewers have as well. But Rafi, can you give us a little bit of your background and particularly your wonderful heritage as being an Armenian? And it's a very proud community that you come from and a very incredible historical nation that you represent. So can you share something about your background as an Armenian and also what led you and drove you to really campaign on behalf of recognition of the Armenian genocide that occurred over 100 years ago by the Ottoman Turks?
Right. Being an Armenian itself, it's quite a responsibility. I was born in Iran, not in Armenia or in Turkey. But from day one, when we start growing and become children at schools, we learn about our history. We gradually find out as to what exactly we represent as Armenians in terms of our culture, in terms of our language and our history. And I think the family also has quite a significant role to play in the educational aspect of Armenians. We carry quite a burden as people. The fact of the genocide always rings our bells, and we become more and more alert as we grow and understand the sense of responsibility that we have in order to educate the world about what happened to the Armenians, and also to bring to light the fact of how Turkey continues to deny the fact and to deny its own history, actually. And therefore, to be a Christian nation, to be able to preserve the language, to be able to survive in the diaspora, and the diaspora is the direct effect of the genocide, and to build up communities, to organize them, and to work towards achieving something for the future generations itself is quite a responsible role. Not many people manage to pull that through, and a lot obviously go and spend time towards their own personal lives. But some of us take the burden and carry the torch and hope that we will gather the momentum and get enough people interested to work with us in order to publicize the cause, and also to gather political interest, to lobby parliaments and MPs and historians, and work with historians that carry out research and bring to surface as to what exactly happened historically. And there's been significant success, I think, over the last 15, 20 years. You would probably know already that over 26 countries have already recognized the Armenian Genocide. 48 states in the United States have voted and recognized the genocide, not the government itself, obviously indirectly under the influence of Turkey. Same applies to the United Kingdom, same applies to Israel. It's sad to see that Israel doesn't recognize the genocide because they, you know, have had the Holocaust and they know everything about both the Armenian Genocide and the Holocaust. There are significant Jewish scholars who have worked and have brought to surface a lot of information. The International Association of Genocide Scholars, Israel Charney used to be the chairman, and he did a lot of work on that. The association also wrote to the president of Turkey at the time, asking them that it's time for them to recognize the Armenian Genocide. But as we know, Turkey plays really hard politics and uses its influence on the Western world to stop what it can and avoid the recognition. And in fact, they worked towards falsification of the history. There's a famous study by the Turkish scholar Taner Akcem, who analyzes the records of the Turkish Historical Society. And within that, he proves how they have falsified history. And he goes into the details of German reporters that at the time were reporting as to what was happening in Turkey or the Ottoman Empire. And piece by piece, he brings to light as to what section of the information has been falsified and published as what the Turkish Historical Society reckoned was the case, which is all false. Unfortunately, Turkey decides to sell us the false information and tries to convince the world that there wasn't a genocide, but it's a proper failure, unfortunately, and it discredits the government as well, that although so many countries have recognized the genocide, it continues to deny its own history. What is significant here is to realize that for a country or a government that bases itself on destruction of a minority or minorities, I should say, because it's not just the Armenians, it was the Kurds, the Armenians, the Assyrians, some of the Jews, Pontic Greeks, they were all subjected to extermination. Jewish people were a bit lucky because at the time the situation changed and they managed to negotiate various things with Israel and things changed and they managed to save themselves as such. However, the rest of the minorities living in Turkey suffered very heavily. So as an Armenian, besides the family life and besides the community life, etc., I think it's key, a key element for some of us at least, to continue to work towards recognition of the Armenian Genocide, to try and convince the government that it is both ethical and in terms of international responsibility and for the future of mankind, they need to recognize the Armenian Genocide. Unless they do, the genocide will continue.
Absolutely.
And as we've seen, there are so many examples.
Yeah. And Rafi, you know, your community just remembered the 102nd anniversary.
Correct,
of
yeah.
the Armenian Genocide. And the fact that this has happened over 102 years ago, where it started 102 years ago. Why is it that this is really described as the forgotten genocide? Why is it that very, very few people know about the Armenian Genocide, when you consider that this was the biggest genocide against Christians in world history, and yet very few people know actually about this horrific event in history?
That is true. There are several reasons. One is that in terms of documentation and also in terms of what was available to communicate at the time what happened in the Ottoman Empire, there's very limited amount of availability of resources that one can get their hands on. That's one case. The second case is that after the genocide, the Armenians were, those that survived, that is, were in a desperate situation. A lot of orphans, a lot of orphanages, new areas and territories that they had no knowledge of. They had to build their homes, they had to survive and get their lives together, form families and, you know, education and work and business and earn their living, etc. So for quite a while, there was not much happening. That's one element. The second element is the fact that Armenia proper was a Soviet, under the Soviet regime. So there was a lot of restrictions and controls on everything. And therefore, they couldn't be active in this respect, although there was some work going on in the background and very quietly. What made the change was the 50th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. That is when the Armenian people in Armenia came out and said, enough is enough, we need to talk about it, we need to voice it, and we need to let the world know what happened. And then it changes from that milestone. So education became a key element, including the genocide studies became an important subject. Quite a few Armenians started researching the subject and digging into the archives. Professor Richard Hovhannessian in California is one of the key players in this respect. at the same time, genocide studies became a more popular subject, generally speaking, not just because of the Armenians. And the development that was led by the International Association of Genocide Scholars led to further work, not just by Armenians, but other scholars on the subject. Gradually, Turkish historians began to develop their interest as to what is this, let's look into it. I remember probably about 20 years ago, there was a conference on Turkey at SOAS, and a few of us were interested and went and participated. And it was really commendable that a Turkish historian from Germany that was presenting a subject, he came up very clear, very clean-cut, and he said, as young students at the university in Turkey, we decided that, hang on, what is this Armenian genocide everyone is talking about? Let's go and research. And they went to the National Archives, a group of three or four of them, to research the subject and look into the publications at the time, etc. And he said, 5 minutes into our entry, the military walked in, and he used the term, they kicked us out of the archives and locked up the whole area. Obviously, they cleansed it, and they took away what they should have taken away to hide what was the truth. But besides that, researchers have continued, and one of the best work that has gone on was the research carried out by Taner Akçam in America, the historian who's managed to publish several books and has studied several aspects of the genocide and how it was organized, how it was perpetrated. And one of the key elements that he refers to is how organized it was and how much communication there was between the regions and the gendarmes of the regions and the interior ministry in terms of statistical movements of the people, survivors, and the deaths and everything.
Yeah, this is to remind you that we are live, we are interactive, we love your views and comments. My question really is to all of you, do you think that it's time that the British government officially recognised the Armenian genocide? So I'd love to hear from you. Rafi, now, one of the main reasons you're here is because of a very brave and courageous film made by Terry George called The Promise about the Armenian genocide. Now, I believe it's the hope and the aspiration of the Armenian community and the Armenian nation to finally have their story told on the big screen, in which is released throughout cinemas throughout the UK on Friday. What is so special about this film, The Promise?
I was fortunate enough to see it last week, and I should thank both Revelation TV and the Christian Solidarity Worldwide for organising the screening. As far as the Armenians are concerned, I think this film is probably the most significant feature film made on the subject. Documentaries are relevant and are screened at various occasions, and there are quite a few documentaries that are made, but not as a feature film. The issue with documentaries is that not many people are interested to sit and watch a documentary, but a feature film that is quite a significant work in terms of its directorship, in terms of the acting at the, and the actors, is quite attractive. And we're hoping that people would go through the trouble of watching this film and come to their own conclusions. It's interesting to note that as soon as the knowledge of the film was available, Turkey moved towards countering and try to put a stop on the production for quite a few years, obviously with its governmental links, etc. However, the effort was continued and the film was finally released, but at the same time they came up with another film to counter the efforts of this film and trying to again come up with a diversion to hide the truth. And they came up with the Ottoman soldier. But I hope that people will pay attention to two elements of this. One, that it's a feature film that has had quite a significant research to try and portray the history as it happens. So that's one element. And those that are interested with the history of the region and how during the end of World War I and the stages of destruction of the Ottoman Empire, what were the steps that the Ottoman authorities took in order to change the situation and come up with a republic as such, and at what price. That is quite an interesting history element, and I'm hoping that people would be willing to go and see the film. Having seen the film, I think say clearly that the acting is really wonderful, the screenplay is really good, the I would probably say that no effort has been saved in order to present the film in an elaborate and an interesting manner, and the storyline captures you. It's a very captivating piece of story, and the flow of the scenario also is quite interesting. It doesn't tire you. You're completely tuned into it and go through the process. But at the same time, what is significant is how it actually shows the various stages of the genocide and how the development took place, and how suddenly the Turkish people turned against the Armenians. Something very extraordinary, because prior to that, Armenians lived very happily in Turkey, and they had significant role in Turkey. There are several examples, but one of the key elements that probably people are not aware is how important roles Armenian minority had in Turkey during the 1908, 1909 to 1940s, 1914. One of the key elements that is quite a famous case is the architecture of Istanbul. Almost all of the important sites and buildings are designed by Armenian architects. Balyan family is one of the famous ones, and there is significant work that has been gone on to publicize the quality of work that they've produced, and there are monuments that are still standing and everyone is enjoying it. It's a part of the World Heritage. But there was also ministers, there were doctors, there were military personnel, civil servants, you name it, lawyers, solicitors, accountants, teachers, poets, everything. And the Armenians lived quite a rich cultural life, and they contributed to the Ottoman Empire's culture as well. There were a lot of Armenians educated in Europe that returned and contributed to developing the country, and the Ottoman Empire benefited from that. But obviously the policy changed and they totally turned against the Armenians.
So let's have a look now at the trailer of the new film about the Armenian genocide. This is the third attempt. There's been an attempt to actually make this film, the first in the 1930s, and the Turkish government put pressure on Hollywood not to produce it, and again in the 70s. And finally, the film about the Armenian genocide hits our big screens in the UK on Friday. So let's have a look now at a trailer for the film, The Promise.
Be careful.
Thank you.
Shoot him!
The world is at your feet, Mikhail. Do us proud.
You're going to become a doctor?
Yes, it's my passion.
Christopher Myers.
Chris is a star reporter for the Associated Press.
A toast to old friends and new.
Bravo!
Anna is a fine woman, Mikhail.
You make me feel I've come home.
She's very fond of you. It's obvious.
It's very dangerous for Armenians right now. I want to get you out of here.
If it's not safe for me, then it's not safe for any of my people.
What is the Associated Press doing here?
Reporting on the war.
There is no war here.
No one here is safe.
Who says
I have to get us out of here before there's no time left.
I was told that you organized an escape, Brent.
How can I help?
Do you love him?
You trust no one.
Chris?
We will build a future together.
A very powerful and emotional film, and having seen it myself, I can highly recommend that you go and see it, primarily to tell Hollywood a message that we need to see more films like this, of this historic and historical nature of the covering important issues like the Armenian Genocide. Anyway, got an email here from Pamela, who writes, just watched the movie in Belfast in the past few minutes. Well, I'm glad you switched on. Mm-hmm. Very, very, very sad. But the statement Anna made, the greatest revenge is that we survive, says it all. All genocide and man's inhumanity against man. The acting is incredible. Spectacular panoramic stages. No expense spared. Everyone should watch the movie. Thank you, Revelation TV. And that's from Pamela in Belfast. So thank you for that one. So please go and watch the film. It's out this Friday. I have to really ask you, Rafi, how the Armenian people went to living in peaceful coexistence with their Ottoman neighbors prior to the start of the First World War. And then they find themselves at the hands of the Young Turks, who were driven by this racial policy to purify the Ottoman Empire of any Christian minorities or anyone else, how this led to the mass extermination of your people that resulted in the death of over 1.5 million Armenians and other Christian minority groups.
That's right. The life of the Armenians in the Ottoman Empire was quite an interesting both culturally and politically, I would say, and in terms of commercial aspects as well, because there were a lot of Armenian merchants, an elite of educated people who were contributing, as I said, to the whole aspect of the empire. And they lived quite happily with Turkish people in the same towns, and there were mosques and churches together in the same town, and people respected one another, etc. So the background is, generally speaking, quite an amicable situation as such. There are moments in history, and especially in the 1890s, that Sultan Abdulhamid turns against the Armenians and exterminates over 300,000 Armenians. So there are these moments in history that the Armenians have clearly suffered. However, if we consider the 20th century and prior to the Armenian Genocide in 1915 and the World War, it was quite a comfortable life for Armenians. And it's clear from history and from research that the Armenians were contributing significantly. And at the same time, the empire was benefiting from the Armenians. So it was a give-and-take situation as such. There were lots of Armenian doctors that were looking after the communities. There were lots of lawyers and accountants and merchants, etc. So it was an acceptable way of life as such. There's also significant records that shows how the Armenian people lived in a quite an elaborate life, the way they were dressed, the way the schools were managed, the way the education was handled, how poetry and culture was surviving and developing. All these aspects are quite interesting. And what the Western Armenian culture has contributed to the Armenian culture overall is a significant portion of our culture. There are poets that when you read about the Western Armenian poetry, you see how deep they've delved into the psyche of human being and how they've expressed it, how interestingly they've come up with various theatrical plays, how it has it develops and it starts to interact with Western cultures. So what they've contributed to the Ottoman Empire is significant. And therefore, one would expect that that relationship would gradually enrich the life and it would result in a positive relationship and develop further. However, when the Young Turks took over, and because of the situation that the empire suffered and the Ottoman Empire was on the rim of collapse, they suddenly started realizing that they need to do something to save the situation and save their faces as well. And that is when the idea of purification comes into mind, and it begins to take shape, and the key players sit together and start planning, start thinking as to what we can do, what are the key elements that we need to sort out. And clearly the decisions are taken. Initially in 1914, they decide to relocate the Armenians, and the deportation plans start taking shape. But by 1915, and as the situation was getting more severe, the whole thing changed and became an extermination plan. And that is how the genocide starts to take shape in terms of planning. Then a huge effort was put into organizational aspects, how it needs to be managed, what steps should be followed. And the key elements that comes to light during research are the following, that one of the first things they did was to make sure that all the able-bodied, and especially the military personnel that were Armenians, were separated, initially jailed, and then in groups they were taken away and executed. Then they turned into the elite, which is significantly important on the 24th of April, because that is the night that they captured all the Armenian intellectuals in the elite in Istanbul, and over 250 lawyers, doctors, ministers, you name it, all the elite was separated and taken away, and in groups again they were exterminated. Having done that, then they turned into the young men, men aged 16 to 20, and they separated them again and took them away and exterminated them. And following that, the grouping of old people, women and children comes into play, and moving them across the empire. If I recall, there are 306 human caravans that are shifting throughout the empire and moving them towards the deserts of Syria. That brings into effect 26 concentration camps in Syria. And then there is this issue of communication between each region and the internal ministry as to how many people were deported and how many managed to reach the destination as to where the concentration camps were. And if the numbers were significant, number of survivors, which wasn't in general because of the harsh conditions of the desert, and what was also considered was that the deportation took place in June, July, August, which is the hottest season in the desert of Syria. And anyway, if there were significant survivors, then again, a further action was taken to exterminate some of them. Fortunately, some of us managed to survive and live on to tell the story.
We've just got a few more emails in. This is from Dermot in Ireland, who writes, current geopolitical realities block any highlighting of the Armenian genocide. There are nuclear weapons stationed in Turkey, but under American control. Turkey is an ally of the West in theory, but this alliance is on shaky ground. The Armenian question will remain in the background for the foreseeable future. And that's where we all need to play our role in making sure that the world knows that the Armenian genocide took place. This one says, I've got a book about this subject, and that's Maureen, and it's a very important subject. I want to go on now, Rafi, and discuss the actual just the actual policies actually carried out, as you mentioned previously there, by the Ottoman Turks, in the most horrific and barbaric ways in which they slaughtered your people. I mean, this is where we get the idea of the death marches, yes, sending out the women and children into the Syrian desert at the heat of summer to die of starvation and heat stroke and hydration. Absolutely horrific. And other policies as well. I mean, the conversation we had prior to this program, I think, was highly significant, because at the time, the Ottoman Empire had aligned themselves with Germany during, yes, the First World War and the Axis powers. So how much did the German Empire know that the genocide against the Armenians was actually taking place? And was it taking place under their watch?
Indeed, it was. There were several Turkish German officers who essentially were there to train the military, the Ottoman military. And therefore, they were present in various locations and clearly witnessing what was happening. There are a few elements that become very important to note and to realize. One, that what happened, the events that took place, were under their eyes. They could see it, they knew about it, but they obviously were quiet about it because they were allies, and therefore they let it go on. But it's not just the military personnel. There were other missionaries and even military personnel. One of the significant documentation that we have is the photographs of Armin Wenger, who's a German officer. But he goes around and takes photographs of the Armenian genocide, and it's readily available on the net. Everyone can see it. It itself is a significant record to show that there was a genocide. But at the same time, the missionaries also report, and there is significant records on the German archives that have been researched, and they bring to light the various levels and details about the Armenian genocide and how it was carried out. The next element, which becomes very important to note and to understand, is that the recent research that the German academicians have come up with clearly shows a linkage between the Armenian genocide and the Holocaust. Some of the German officers that were in Germany at the in Turkey at the time, or in the Ottoman Empire at the time, later become advisors to Hitler, military advisors to Hitler. So this is a significant element to consider. Some of the measures that were taken, moving the people on trains from one location to another for extermination, it's the same situation that happened in the Armenian genocide case, although in a smaller scale and less industrialized scale, but later on it gets developed and becomes a key element of what or how the Jewish people were transported to the concentration camps. So yes, there is a significant amount of relevance and parallels that one needs to be aware of. Referring to the issue of Turkish role and the being a military base or nuclear base for the United States, yes, that is true. But also one needs to realize that it's not just that fact. What also is significant is Turkish people. They also have begun to realize that there was something and it's being covered. So there is significant work going on both inside and outside Turkey by academicians especially, and academicians that are not directly under the influence of the government, in other words, the governmental universities, who are finding out more and more information about the reality of the Armenian genocide. So we're hoping that this will have a gradual effect, however slow, and in time the public opinion in Turkey will begin to influence the government, and hopefully they will start thinking more responsibly about the history.
So let's have a look at this item that explains maybe 8 facts about the Armenian genocide that you or I didn't know.
Today we will speak about 8 facts you may not know about the Armenian genocide. On April 24th, 1915, roughly 200 Armenian leaders were executed by the Turkish army. The early stages of the genocide are marked by the murders of Armenian male leaders. Before the genocide, the Young Turks regime disarmed the entire Armenian population. Every weapon was seized, and those who failed to turn in a weapon were subject to penalties. The photo displays the Young Turks entering Istanbul. The Young Turks aimed to Turkify Armenian children. They kidnapped children, converting them to Islam, and adopted them out to Turkish families. The photo shows an alleged Turkish official teasing Armenian children with food. More than a million Armenians were subject to death marches across rocky terrain to the Syrian desert. An estimated 75% of the Armenians on these death marches died, and many of the survivors were burned alive or thrown off cliffs. There were roughly 2 million Armenians living in the Ottoman Empire before the genocide. By 1922, there were just 388,000 Armenians remaining. As a result of the violence, there were more than 150,000 Armenian orphans roaming the streets. Some were Turkified, while others were killed or forced into slavery, but most died of starvation or disease. The photo illustrates Armenian refugees in Syria. Turkey has not formally recognized the genocide. Turkey's prime minister recently offered his condolences over the massacre, but condemned Pope Francis for calling the massacres the first genocide of the 20th century. An Armenian church canonized the victims as martyrs, to which Erdogan responded, 30 million people died, and why are you highlighting the Armenian citizens? More than 4 million Muslims died during the war. Due to political ties with Turkey, President Obama abstained from using the word genocide when commemorating the 100th anniversary of the massacres. Grand Vizier Damad Farid Pasha recognized the genocide by holding war crimes trials that commanded to death the major leaders responsible. It is far from my thought to cast a veil over these misdeeds, which are such as to make the conscience of mankind shudder with horror forever. Still less will I endeavor to minimize the degree of guilt of the actors in the great drama. The aim which I have set myself is that of showing to the world with proofs in my hand who are the truly responsible authors of these terrible crimes. Damad Farid Pasha, the Ottoman Grand Vizier.
Astonishing, isn't it? Over 102 years ago that the Ottoman Turks started to carry out the Armenian genocide back in 1915, and yet still to this date that the Turkish government still refuses to recognize their role and responsibility in the Armenian genocide. And talking about that, Rafi, despite all the photographic evidence we saw on that presentation, despite all the eyewitness accounts and the personal testimonies that this took place, how has the world remained silent, and how has Turkey managed to get away with this for over 102 years when you consider the international condemnation that was brought upon the Nazis for committing the Holocaust?
Yes. Basically, it's the key role that Turkey has as a NATO state. Obviously neighboring Russia, and therefore its strategic position is a key element in any consideration as far as politics goes. On top of that, there is the significant investments that have taken place in Turkey and allowed it to develop to the state that it is now. So there is a huge amount of economic interest that continues to exist as far as the Western world is concerned. The situation changes only slightly after the recognition of the French government of the Armenian Genocide. Although Turkey protested heavily and they withdrew the Turkish ambassador from France and so on, but gradually went back to a normal relationship. What is significant here to realize it is the fact that a government took a responsible position, obviously because there is a significant number of Armenians living there, but at the same time also as a government it decided to forego the interest that it had, the immediate interest that it had with Turkey and as a member of NATO as well, and come up with a decision that is a just decision. They also have significant amount of archives that indicates there was a genocide. So as far as the voting was concerned, there was no doubt, and therefore they made that leap as such, as a step, and came up with a decision which created quite a big noise internationally. And gradually following that, we have various other states that gradually start to look at the facts, listen to the Armenians, listen to historians, and become more and more responsible in terms of how they position themselves as far as decision-making is concerned. And that is how the number of countries started to gradually increase. Even for Turkey, and I'm sure even for Erdogan and his team, they are clearly aware of what exactly has happened. It's not that they are not aware of the facts and they're just standing there saying, no, Turkey never did that. Mm-hmm. But in terms of their pride, in terms of their continued position over the years saying that there wasn't a genocide, it's a very difficult step for them to suddenly come to a realization of, hang on, we better start accepting the facts. This is quite a significant case, and their position has been very clear. They clearly deny it. And one of the key elements of genocide is the final stage, which is the denial. And therefore, it is expected. If Turkey wants to become a democracy, it's the only way for them. There is not a second way. If Turkey wants to become part of Europe, it's the only way for them, unless they face history and take responsibility for what they did and make repairs. They cannot become a democracy. Not just for Armenians or just for other people, for Turkish people themselves. It's a responsibility that the government needs to, at some point, come to realization and take the right measures. However, as it stands, and as we know, they continue to deny and they continue to build a more undemocratic state. In fact, the recent voting that took place gave Erdogan more power. Although the international observers were quite critical of what happened and the voting was only a 55% majority, but still he has now more powers. And that clearly indicates a dictatorship and a direction that goes towards dictatorship rather than democracy.
Yeah, scary prospect. I'm just going to read out this email from Brian, who writes, good evening. I definitely think that the British government should recognise the Armenian genocide, especially in light as to the direction Erdogan is heading, seemingly back to an imperial Muslim-run country. We can also see his hate for the Kurds, and he seems to be attempting to lead his country back into a new Ottoman Empire. And being an important member of NATO should also concern us, especially with some of his recent rants at Europe. This genocide against mainly Christians during the First World War should be brought out into the open just as much as we recognise the genocide of the Jews during the Second World War. The truth has to be told. Blessings, Brian. So thank you for an extremely intelligent and informative email from Brian. We're down to the last 5 minutes, so 4 minutes of the program. Rafi's gone very quickly. In terms of advocacy. I mean, prayer is obviously something that is very important, and we can pray that for the Armenian people, and we can pray for justice. But in terms of political action, what role can we play to help our politicians, particularly as we're now approaching a general election, to understand what happened regarding the Armenian genocide and how important it is to engage with our political representatives to say you need to put pressure on the Foreign Office and the British government to actually acknowledge the Armenian genocide, because True. It's the right thing to do.
True. There are two sides to this aspect. One is that politicians, as they are, initially and immediately consider the interest of the country and the both geopolitical and economical interests. And therefore, the immediate response we get from politicians is that, yes, there was a genocide, but there is this aspect, and therefore we need to consider that, and therefore we are not going to support the case of the recognition. And that has been the position for quite a long time now. It's interesting that over the recent years, there's been a slight change in the government position and the Foreign Office's position. They now know that there was a genocide. They indirectly accept the fact that there was a genocide and even express themselves that it's embarrassing to deny it. They find themselves now in an embarrassing position. But the answer they give in terms of the next step is, instead of saying, okay, let's be responsible and let's do something about it, because they knew at the time as well there was a huge amount of publicity going on, they say that it's down to Turkish and Armenian people to come to reconciliation. Now let's bring an example here which is quite relevant, and I'll try and be as quick as possible. In the centenary year, Erdogan moved its machinery to try and create some sort of dialogue with the Armenians in the diaspora. They went to America, and the Armenians in America rejected to have a dialogue, knowing what exactly is behind the picture. They came to London, and me and my colleagues said, okay, let's try. Let's sit and talk with them. And we sat. We sat and had a discussion. And they were essentially campaigning for creating an atmosphere of positive thinking so that the population in Turkey will vote for Erdogan. And that was basically it. There was nothing else that they were prepared to give as such. And when we said, okay, we're prepared to cooperate, what have you got to offer? And their response, and one of the responsible people at the conference who represented an organization, said that as long as you don't expect us to come up with any sort of a reparation, particularly land, and recognition of the genocide, we can talk. And I said, well, let's put the cards on the table. If you are putting any preconditions, there will be no conversation and no talk. And that is the position they have.
Rafi, I just want to thank you so much for being my guest on The Late Show tonight.
And, it was a pleasure, thank you.
I personally want to thank you for not only being such an eloquent spokesman on behalf of your community, but your passion and your desire for justice for your people is just incredible. So I really do ask our viewers to keep you in our prayers and for everything you're doing. So thank you for being
on
this program today. And I just want to thank you for watching The Late Show tonight, when we've all learnt about the Armenian genocide. One of the best ways that we can learn about the Armenian genocide is to watch the new film, The Promise, that hits the cinemas on Friday. So we can learn about this. One's great if you have children or grandchildren, so that they can go along and see the film as well, because it's imperative that they understand what happened in history. And this song is dedicated to the Armenian people who were massacred over 100 years ago during the First World War by the Ottoman Turks.
tell you.